my name is Leah Bell, and I'll be your host for this month's episode of The Helm. First up, photography is having a meeting April 23rd and 25th from 2:30 to 4 p.m. in room 162. Next, Luke Pruitt has a Q&A with Sarah Ormiston in his segment, 20 Questions.
Hello, and welcome to another segment of 20 Questions. Today, we have a special guest, Sarah Ormiston. Hello,
Hi.
Sarah.
Hi.
So, Sarah, today we're going to be asking you 20 questions, some that are serious and not so serious. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
What's the best part about being on the basketball team?
I would say being with my friends and, like, playing a sport, because I've been playing for, like, 7 years.
How many shots have you made this season?
70.
Sorry, what did you say?
70.
What's your favorite cartoon?
Tom and Jerry.
If you could go on vacation anywhere in the world, where would it be?
Italy.
What are your favorite sports to watch?
Baseball, football, basketball.
Is Santa Claus real or fake?
I don't know. I don't think so.
What's your favorite Disney show?
My favorite Disney show. I always like Jonas Sally and I liked Good Luck Charlie.
What positions do you play in basketball?
Point guard, and I shoot. A lot.
Do you like wearing Adidas or Nike?
Nike.
Where's your favorite place to go out to eat?
Ooh, I like going to Sparks or I like the trackside pizza.
When you get home from school, what's the first thing you do?
Watch TV or take a nap.
What are your top three favorite colors?
Ooh, red. I like red a lot. Say green or orange.
And who's your favorite artist?
One Direction.
Would you rather swim at the lake or go snowboarding?
Swimming.
And what's the funniest face you can make? There you go. And what's your best joke you can tell us?
How do you make a hot dog stand?
How?
Take away its chair.
If you couldn't go to PHS, what school would you go to?
Go to any other school because PHS is the best.
What's your celebration dance after a shot? Do you have any secret handshakes with anybody?
I have one.
And what do you want your legacy to be at PHS?
My legacy is like, I was diagnosed with autism when I was 8, and I want people to be like, feel like they can't be a person if you have a disability or not. So just be yourself and don't let people bring you down.
And this has been an episode of 20 Questions with your host Luke Pruitt and Sarah. And thanks for coming on, Sarah.
Yo, what's up, guys? This is Sarah.
What's up?
Like over there, so it's out of the camera, real quick.
Here, Mr. Carr, you can take a snooze.
All right, ready? So.
Oh!
There you go. All right, that's all.
You forgot 20.
Dude, the car. You can't let him sleep all day.
Reporter Mason Justino covers teacher cuts and how they'll affect our school.
With the recent news of teacher cuts taking place throughout the district, I decided to talk to those that could be directly affected by it.
This is my first year here, and it's kind of the perfect thing for me because I'm part-time, which is what I wanted. I have a really perfect schedule, and I'm doing something that I love. So I think it would be pretty hard to replicate what I'm doing elsewhere. So if I would lose my job here, I might sub. I've subbed before. Or if I found a job in another district that was really close to me, this is also perfect for me because it's really close to my house, there's probably a way to work it out where they wouldn't have to go to the extremes like this, especially like people like me who are already part-time. My experience with teaching as teacher in the state is so limited that I'm like at the very bottom of the pay scale. And so a lot of the teachers that would get cut are those that are kind of at the bottom or lower ranks of the pay scale. So it doesn't feel like it's that much of a money-saving option if they're just cutting the newer teachers. I was disappointed, and I was pretty shocked, and I've gone through a lot of emotions about it. Like, I've been sad about it, mad about it, disappointed.
Mr. Sunich served on the district negotiations team for the teachers' pay raises and was able to provide the district's perspective of the cuts taking place.
I think anytime you're looking at a budget, you got to look at the whole picture and look for different ways you can reduce expenses and set your priorities on what's most important to you. I think one of the challenges that sometimes we run into when we look at the immediate is that we're looking at things that will be one-time money. A lot of times people are pointing out things like, well, if we just didn't buy this thing, whether it be computers or some other program or whatever else for the district, it might save some teachers at that point. But once that money is spent, it's gone. And then down the road, we're going to find ourselves in that same position again, because paying for teachers is an ongoing expense. And so that's not money you want to use your savings account for.
I also asked Sunish if during the negotiations, there was talk of teacher cuts taking place.
Based on projections for what the budget would be and what the intended or negotiated salaries were going to be, there was some pretty clear communication saying at this level, we would anticipate we would have to reduce by this many teachers, and the union representatives were aware of those, and we all kind of had to come to an agreement with what everybody could live with.
Mrs. Paris, one of PHS's union representatives for the Puyallup Educators Association, gave her thoughts on the cuts as well.
I know that there's issues of the funding. I know that when the new contracts were bargained last year, statewide there was an issue with the legislature having cut the levy funding and made it so that districts like Puyallup and a lot of other districts in the state were not exactly being cut, but were given less control over the funding that they had. And some of the programs that we run through levies aren't sustainable at the level of levy funding right now. So I understand that, but the legislature is passing new laws right now that allow for the levy to be funded at the previous level or something close to it, and it's happening soon. And a lot of districts around us aren't cutting right now, even though they're in the same boat, because they know that the funding issue is gonna change and they don't know what it's gonna look like. So right now what we've done is we've sent a message to our newer teachers that it's not secure to work here, that there's a possibility that their jobs will be cut here, or they'll be teaching 50 kids in a class next year. And the districts around us, there's some that are hiring and there are others that at the very least are not doing this, that might be a better place to work. And so my overall concern is we have some people who don't really have a reason to stay, because there's a loyalty issue when you tell somebody very quickly and without a lot of information that they're gone, and other districts are just being more loyal right now. That's how I feel about it. That's my thoughts on it. None of us are really ignorant people, so we understood the math behind it. But the issue is the state legislature, and the issue is getting the levies fixed for places like here in Tacoma and Yakima. And that's something that can't be controlled at the district level. That has to be done by the state. So everybody agreed that what we need to do is work with the state to get the problem fixed. And we're working with the state, and the problem is close to being fixed, in which case what we're doing right now is premature because we don't know what the funding will look like. That's the thing, is that the issue had to be resolved at a state level, and trying to fix it at a district level like this isn't a fix.
Although it's not yet certain what teachers won't be seeing in the classroom next year, the one thing that is certain is class sizes will be increasing and teacher sizes will be decreasing. This has been Mason Justino reporting for Viking Student Media.
Last, interviews with the boys from Mr. Puyallup and their experiences.
Hey, I'm Jason Soup, here at the Mr. Puyallup, thingy. So my position is Mr. Football, for PHS. We got other people like Mr. Worldwide, we got Mr. Soccer, we got Mr. Basketball, other various things. Training for Mr. Puyallup was hectic. I decided to do ukulele, but you know, I can't sing. So I had to get one of my good friends, Amber Susie. So the criteria to win Mr. Puyallup is to be cool. The view, like, who knows? I'm not the judge, so we'll see.
I'm Andrew Irby, and I am Mr. Cross Country for Mr. Puyallup. And my escort is Sydney Lewis, and my talent will be playing the trumpet. It was really just a lot of fun, a lot of time well spent with friends, lots of time spent during lunch, lots and lots, time after school, before school, and a lot of practicing at home as well. It's just been a great time being Mr. Cross Country for Mr. Puyallup. It's just been an honor to be part of this. It's been really fun.
My name is Anna Hoganson. I'm escorting Jace Coulter, who is Mr. Wrestling. And a little bit about what goes planning into this. It's just a lot of teamwork and hard work. It takes a lot of choreography, and it's a whole lot of planning. So we gotta plan months in advance. But it's always really fun getting to hang out with the boys and just you have fun together, dance around, and just do your thing. It's fun.
All right. First of all, my name is Javier Segueiro González. I'm Mr. Worldwide, and my escort is Ilenia Reale. She's from Italy too, so we can say we're the Mr. Worldwide and Mrs. Worldwide couple. What I really liked, it was the team we made, the second lance, for what I know, and just practicing whenever they tell us. And you know, in Spain, we're not really into this kind of things, the shows and whatever, so I really enjoyed it. Helped me getting rid of all my the shame I had, and talking to the public and everything, and it's really I feel really accomplished with all I've worked for, all I've done to learn Despacito, and I think it's been a really great experience.
Ms. Rosdahl, what have you liked the most about interviewing all these contestants?
I think it's funny to watch you guys squirm when we give you questions. I think it's hilarious when we ask you what your name is and you go, I think that's funny.
I love that answer, Ms. Rosdahl. So let's see, who do you think is gonna win? Come on, your predictions.
Oh, well, I have to be a little bit, I can't be too impartial because I am talking to Mr. Worldwide.
She said Mr. Worldwide, you heard it.
I said
Mr.
I Worldwide. Can't be too impartial when I'm talking to one of the contestants. I feel like I'm obligated to say Mr. Worldwide, right?
You're not obligated to, but you said it. Yeah. It's on camera. Hey, Ms. Rosdahl, again, we come back to you. So what have you found the toughest thing in interviewing all of us?
The toughest thing is trying not to laugh because you guys' answers are so funny.
You think Despacito is better than Pitbull?
I think you really messed up when you didn't do Pitbull for Mr. Worldwide.
Disagree.
But you know I love Despacito. I love
that
song.
We love Despacito.
I love that song. Is it actually recording?
Oh, for sure.
Can I have this?
Holy moly! And here we go, guys.
Brandon,
BW Lime, Cigarette and Mingle.
With your waves. Shout out to my girl, Alexa McNaughton, for escorting me. I was her dad. Oh, here she is. I was gonna get a hug. I thought I was gonna get a hug.
No,
this is a Gucci belt.
Yee, brother!
I played the piano, you know? And I played when I was younger, and then I had to relearn everything.
About to get this dub with the Gucci belt.
A dub, of course. We'll see.
Thank you for watching this month's episode of The Helm. We'll see you next time.